Welcome to All About Money on HK IBC. I'm Chloe Fung. Hong Kong's economy has seen a strong recovery in the first quarter, growing 2.7% year-on-year on back of a tourism revival. But for many companies, their biggest headache is due to the manpower shortage. An ongoing immigration wave since COVID has led to a severe brain drain for the city. And while authorities are going all out to attract talent globally, most of those who applied for the work visas come from mainland China. So how can Hong Kong better entice businesses and talent from other parts of the world? Joining us today is Mr. Inaki Amate, the chairman of the European Chamber of Commerce in Hong Kong, who will share his thoughts on the city's current business climate as well as economic outlook. So welcome to our show, Inaki. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me.
And as I just mentioned earlier in the beginning, we've seen a strong recovery in Hong Kong's economy in the first quarter. But from your point of view or from what you've seen, did you see more companies wanting to grow their business, more people wanting to grow their business in the city after border reopening? What is the current business sentiment in Hong Kong?
I think it's pretty optimistic and quite positive in the sense that we definitely see more companies requesting coming and visiting Hong Kong. We have seen many more missions of companies from the different national chambers in the European Chamber of Commerce willing to come to Hong Kong to reconnect, to see again what is the situation in Hong Kong and see what is also happening across the border. So they have many times used basically Hong Kong as a base to then go into mainland China.
So would you say that Hong Kong is really back on business?
It's definitely on the trajectory. I think there is still a long way to go before we reach a point that is near where we were before the COVID. But we definitely see that there is definitely all the indicators, all the signals that the situation is going into the right direction.
And last year, in an interview, you said that several organizations in Hong Kong had lost up to 20% of their individuals in 2021, and there was a small rebound. But what about the situation this year? After the border reopened, did you see a membership boost in both the chambers, for example, European Chamber and the Spanish Chamber, which you chair?
I wouldn't call it a boost. I think what we are seeing is that we are going back to the situation that was before COVID in terms of typical attrition of members. So there are still those that are leaving Hong Kong. We're starting to see some people finally moving back into Hong Kong. But we don't see like masses of people returning, or we don't see corporations or companies that left coming back. That's not happening yet. We're starting to see signals, like I said before, of organizations that are thinking, okay, is this how, if we want to start doing business in that part of the world, or if we had business in that part of the world, what should be our situation now? How do we reassess whether it's a good place to be? And given the changes that have happened, the macroeconomical and macro-political changes that have happened in the last 3 years, what should be our presence in that part of the world? That assessment is happening. So many organizations come to the city. The leaders that were not able to come to the city during these last 3 years are coming and talking to the local teams to basically assess, you know, what is going to be different moving forward. Do we need to keep investing? Do we need to divest? Do we need to diversify? All that is happening as we speak.
What would be the major concern from your point of view for those foreign companies? You earlier mentioned about the, for example, geopolitical tensions. What are the other areas that caused concerns for you the most?
Yeah, I think the main one is that actually people that have not been visiting the city have developed their own image of what is happening in this part of the world that is not necessarily the reality. So for us, the most important thing is that, I mean, those that are having a connection, a relationship with Hong Kong and the south of China, they should come and visit. They should come and see by themselves what is happening in this part of the world. They should develop a realistic perspective and then with that make the right decisions. It's very important that you come and see that actually the number of opportunities and projects that are happening here are probably not, there are not too many places in the world where you can find the big opportunities that are at the moment here, right? So I think it's important that they see by themselves, that we also convey to the rest of the world, you know, what is the reality here, and work together with the different organizations and going back to our countries and tell headquarters of those companies that have a presence in Hong Kong that The situation has definitely changed dramatically. There's a lot of opportunities. There are lots of opportunities right now, and you should come and see by yourself.
So you still take more efforts in order to deliver those messages effectively. And let's say also focus on the talent issue, because the city has been undergoing the severe brain drain since last year. And because of this issue, Chief Executive John Lee has rolled out the top talent pass scheme to attract talent globally. But from what we've get the data so far, the majority or the some 95% of the applicants are from mainland China. Only 3% are from Canada, Australia, the US, and Singapore. What are the reasons behind, like, not many talents are coming to the city to explore the opportunities because of the issue you just mentioned?
I think it's a combination of the fact that, I mean, many people abroad don't know that there are these schemes in place, and they don't know what is the situation in Hong Kong. So the first thing is actually to make sure that, I mean, people get access to the information and the opportunities that are basically in the city. The second thing is that we've been also arguing that at the moment the current scheme is a little too narrow, focused in two tiers. Organizations in Hong Kong, companies in Hong Kong need a very wide range of talent, not just the top tier of recently graduated or white collar. We need people across the board. We have lost so many people in all the different ranks and positions in across all different sectors that expecting that that's going to be just substitute with people coming from mainland China is going to be very unrealistic, especially if you want to keep the status of an international business hub. You need to have people that not only know how to command in an international environment, but sometimes the type of organizations that we represent, they need people that understand also the culture, the language of the company's headquarters that typically are countries in Europe. So we need people very diverse. We need people with very diverse background, people coming also from different parts of the world than just China. And I think that it's important also to understand that in order to attract these people, you need to have like a very competitive offer. And the offer at the moment is not known, but also when the top people in the world can decide whether they come here or they go to Silicon Valley or they go to some place in Southern Europe, they are going to probably say, okay, what is Hong Kong offering me that these other places are not offering? And, you know, the living standards, you know, I think when people, especially if you are in certain age group, you want to have, you know, more space because you come with a young family, you are looking for a good education,
children,
international education. I think you need to keep all these things in mind when thinking about what are we offering to the rest of the world, right?
But speaking of that, Hong Kong is offering like some, let's say, initiative or concessions as well. For example, we have the tax rebate, and we also have some adjustment on the stamp duty as well.
Yes.
So these are not enough for them, like to attract them then.
They are not enough and they are not known. So we have the combination of the two. I think that we probably need to look more carefully about what really matters to the type of people that we want to bring in as well. I think it's important to understand that some of the things that we used to have for granted in Hong Kong probably have, if not disappeared, have deteriorated or changed in the last years. For example, We claim that, I mean, the use of English needs to be back to Hong Kong to a logical level to be able to attract people, especially in the service industry. So I think and that when we look into what are the new jobs that are basically offered in Hong Kong, most of them require Chinese and Cantonese and English. If you want to attract people from abroad, that's not going to be possible because Cantonese and Chinese are, you know, very difficult to get if you are basically educated abroad, right?
So language could be one of the areas that we can look into.
Definitely.
Other than that, what kind of like changes you would like to see from the government in order to make the city's offering more attractive to those global talent,
well,
also the companies?
I think the government is working already in a huge number of measures, but I think anything that the city can do in order to improve the livelihood, so that you know, affect a little bit of how the rents are at a reasonable level. anything that can be done in order to improve the competitiveness of the city, you know, bringing a little bit more a perspective of how to resolve in a very agile manner some of the key issues that are in the city would be also very welcome.
And also, I want to also know that what kind of talent do you think are mostly needed for now?
Like I said before,
acutely needed.
I think we need definitely experts in very different sectors. We need people that come with technology background. In finance, we need people that are pretty much across the whole spectrum of all the different ranks of the organization. Very specialized, but also we need people that are, like I said before, in logistics, in some of the sectors that deal with the manufacturing across the border, like design. We need people that are coming a little bit also with the understanding of what are the markets that we are going to be serving from here. Mm-hmm. So, but definitely everything related to technology is something that the city really needs at the moment.
Hmm. Speaking of technology, I know that you are also an expert in the digital innovation area. And now that Hong Kong is also rolling out its blueprint to develop the city into a IT hub, what do you make of this blueprint? Do you think Hong Kong will really be able to play a more active role in, for example, boosting the innovation and technology development, not only in Hong Kong, but, for example, in the Greater Bay Area or even for the whole China?
I think it's very smart from the city to realize that that's something that it's needed. I think for us, the question is more about how that is going to play with the same ambition that Shenzhen and other cities in the GBA have, right? So how is that going to be combined? Why would you consider Hong Kong and not Shenzhen if you are going to basically have to establish here a hub for innovation? I think definitely the connection to financial services is very interesting when you have the perspective of what Hong Kong really is really strong at. But in order to build something that is seriously considered globally as an international hub, you need to build the whole ecosystem. You need to really think about, you know, how you are educating people from very early stages in their school years all the way to universities. You need to build a connection also with the ecosystem with incentives for startups. And I think the government has come a long way in the last 5-6 years in starting to build it. But a lot more is needed. I mean, when you basically are competing with other big capitals in the world that are trying to do the same, I think that there are still some lessons that we can basically apply to Hong Kong.
And especially for the technology aspect, now we have more intensified geopolitical tensions on this area as well. Would this be some area that, you know, cause your concern that how would this aspect affect Hong Kong's ambition into developing an IT hub?
I think Hong Kong is going to be a very interesting place because the gateway role that plays between China and the rest of the world. Anyone that wants to be a global organization with ambition to serve the global market needs to really think about, you know, how do you basically serve different big regions. And Hong Kong is just the perfect spot for, you know, managing that transition between regions. I definitely think Hong Kong has a role to play.
Lastly, before we go, very quickly, what do you think about Hong Kong's economic outlook for this year? Or how optimistic are you on this?
I think given the fact that, I mean, there is such a big push from the government to, you know, launch so many different incentive schemes and programs, I think that's going to have a tremendous impact into the economy, in different sectors of the economy. I think that we are all very enthusiastic to see how the airport is going to start working again at the pace that it used to be in order to basically see more and more tourists coming through. But just that's just one sector, right? I mean, we think that the other sectors definitely need also a little bit of support and see how they are going to be moving forward with this new positive wave that we are seeing coming in.
All right, thank you very much
for
your thoughts, Inaki. Okay, we will take a short break for now, but coming up next, we'll switch our attention to China to discuss the country's business confidence following some latest investigations. So do stay tuned. Welcome back to All About Money on HK IBC. I'm Chloe Fong. The Ministry of Commerce has dubbed 2023 the year of investing in China, as Premier Li Qiang early vowed to reboot the private sector while calling for extra effort to boost foreign investment. But a recent anti-espionage crackdown targeting some of the world's largest consultancy and due diligence firms has reignited concerns over the risk of doing business in China. So how will the latest development affect foreign business sentiment and China's investment outlook? Let me direct these questions to Mr. Inaki Amate, the chairman of European Chamber of Commerce in Hong Kong, who is with me in the studio. So Inaki, thank you for joining us. Earlier, we have talked about Hong Kong's economic outlook. And now let's focus on China. And the latest development reignited the concerns. And the investigation emerged in late May when authorities raided some offices of CapVision, an expert network group, and followed by some other raids on some blue-chip U.S. firm and due diligence companies. So I'm thinking this development seemingly to have triggered some jitters among the foreign companies as well. How would you rate the latest development impact on the, for example, the investment outlook in China later on?
So it's probably early days, but we haven't really picked up any concerns or signals from our members on this in this topic. I mean, like you said, I mean, this happened recently. I think the overall, the organizations that have already operations or practice in China, they are still very keen to continue working in, and they are probably assessing a little bit more how they are going to continue doing business in China. Those that are relatively new to their region, they probably want to think closely to what is the role that Hong Kong can play in helping them to land easier in China. But other than that, we don't have much to comment at this point.
And but this also came at a time when China is trying to attract more business foreign firms to developing China as well. Observing from Hong Kong, did you see more foreign companies entering the China market to expand or grow their business after the COVID measures were dropped, which was a very major concern?
So we are definitely seeing companies that are going back to China to visit the factories, to visit the partners, to visit even their offices, to assess, you know, what is the situation there. A few weeks ago, I mean, some of our organization members were invited to visit the Guangdong province, and we had an opportunity to actually visit some of the factories, some of them belonging to some European organizations. And it was striking to see that they have not really stopped. The business didn't really stop much during the COVID time. And in fact, even though probably production is lower than it used to be, what we can see is that in the level of investment that those organizations have done during these last years has only strengthened their position and makes us believe that, I mean, there is a huge opportunity in collaborating and doing business across the border. So I think overall, we remain optimistic, and I think our members are very keen to see how that collaboration can continue and are waiting probably to see the demand to pick up to basically see production going back to the levels that it used to be.
Speaking of China's economic recovery, how would you rate its economic recovery pace so far? Would you say that the recovery so far met your expectations?
Well, I think it's definitely impacted by global demand, and we know that there are some regions in the world that they are going through adjustments and difficult challenges, you know, with the energy crisis, inflation. That definitely has an impact also in production, like I mentioned before. So I think the recovery is definitely impacted by that. We see some sectors that are definitely going to be driving the recovery. So like tourism, for example, now that everybody is able to travel, we definitely see that that should be driving a lot of the recovery. So in general, I would say that yes, it's actually, if not better, definitely matching our expectations.
And now that, Inaki, with the latest investigations, we know that many foreign companies actually, if they want to expand business in China, they very rely on those consultancy firms to provide some on-the-ground intelligence, to provide some information for them to know about the latest industry trend as well as national policies. But with the recent, let's say, investigations onto this sector, in the long term, do you think this will somehow dampen the foreign investment sentiment? And how investable is China then, from your perspective, yeah, with such a development?
Like I said before, I mean, it's difficult to say, it's too early to assess, but I would imagine that, I mean, organizations will adapt, like we always do, right? Whenever we have to enter a new market, you basically have to deal with the local nuances, and you basically adjust, and if you really are serious about entering that market. So we need to wait and see a little bit how companies plan to you know, go around this issue. But in general, I think that those that are serious about entering China, they will continue looking into going for it.
On the G7 summit, we've seen recently the G7 leaders also have issued that they are not decoupling from China, but just to de-risk from China. How would you interpret the latest statements or the wordings from the communique that were issued from the G7 leaders?
I don't think the world is benefiting from being more separated and isolated. I think the world benefits from actually collaborating and understanding the differences and building on them. I think that today we need to understand that, especially here in Hong Kong, we have an opportunity to play a role in making that connection between different parties a reality and making people to make the most of it. In our role as a Chamber of Commerce, which is trying to make people to trade, it's super important that we all understand each other a lot better. And I think that's basically what we are expecting and hoping that the world also realizes.
But at the same time, the G7 leaders have said that they are prepared to build stable relations with China, but will also act in their own interests. So I'm thinking, how will the foreign companies from the European region also balance its trade relationship with China with its own interests and strategic agenda?
Yeah, it's not easy, because you need to start navigating also changes in regulation that involve sometimes how you're going to be dealing with the way that you are treating data in one region and another part of the world. Is more work, is more complexity. At the same time, we understand that, I mean, the world is also moving into a direction where probably we're going to see more of that, unfortunately. But yes, I think most of our organizations are basically asking for some clarity. They are asking for simplification. And I think we've been also talking to the government here in Hong Kong about, you know, the role that Hong Kong can actually play in making a little bit easier and simpler the access to China for organizations that want to actually do business there. So I think that there is an opportunity for Hong Kong, again, in helping to simplify for European organizations how to go around the problems around the transference of data or understanding how the regulation is going to work around the GBA area. So all that is something that we are constantly in a dialogue with the government.
And we have been hearing a lot, some relatively negative impacts from the tensions between China, US, and China, EU at some point as well. But from your point of view, what are the areas that China and the European countries can cooperate more with in the future?
Yeah, I mean, definitely around the environment. Everything related to technology and regulation that helps to improve the war against the climate change is something where I think there is a lot of opportunity for collaboration. I would definitely start with that, because that you need a starting point to rebuild and reestablish the trust between people that at the moment probably see the world in different ways, although we are all aiming for the same objective at the end.
All right, we shall see. Thank you very much for yourself, Inaki. That's Inaki Amate, the chairman of the European Chamber of Commerce in Hong Kong. And thank you for watching All About Money. We'll be back next Sunday night at 8:30 p.m. So until the next time, see you then.